Well, thank you, everyone, as we reconvene, and it is a pleasure to introduce our next panel. The aim of this day, as we have said, is to engage in practical and in concrete ways issues that businesses engage as they look at the question of technology and social impact, and specifically in this next panel, to look at questions of data, data governance, and the ways in which organizations respond to questions related to that. It is my pleasure to introduce Bill Russell, CEO of Health Lyrics, Darren Dworkin, the CIO of Cedars-Sinai, and Angelique Russell, data scientist, Precision Health AI. Thank you so much, and welcome.
As the moderator, I'm going to try to face you guys and just have a conversation. I don't know why we do these chairs. These are like the most uncomfortable. I'm afraid I'm going to fall over.
It's very Hollywood.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm really excited to spearhead this conversation. There's so much going on in healthcare, but I want to rewind a little bit because the world really changed in 2007. In 2007, not only were we facing a financial crisis, but we were also facing what I would call a data tidal wave or a data tsunami. And if you think about what happened in 2007, the first thing is data really became mobile. And the acceleration of collection of data really occurred because in 2007, the iPhone was introduced and it kicked off a huge ecosystem. The second thing that happened in 2007 is Netflix started streaming, right? So Netflix started streaming over the internet. Another thing that happened is Google bought YouTube. At that point, Netflix and YouTube accounted for 50% of the global internet traffic. And by the way, that hasn't really changed much since that time in 2007. They're still eating up that much bandwidth. The other thing that happened in 2007 is the Human Genome Project had mapped the human genome for quite a fair amount of money. But what had happened is you saw that number go from $2 million to map the genome down to 200,000. That has since gone down to close to 1,000, and it's now heading south of $1,000 on the human genome mapping. The other thing that happened is Hadoop open source started to appear out there and became the foundation for internet scaling large companies like Facebook, LinkedIn, and Twitter. Today, 2.5 quintillion bytes of data are generated every day. Over the last 2 years, 90% of the world's data was generated. Think about that. The entire world, the last 2 years, 90% of the data was generated. Healthcare is no different. Data pretty much permeates every aspect, research, daily life, experience, ongoing care, preventative care. Stanford Health did a study, their trends, their health data trends study said that the healthcare is growing, the healthcare data is growing at a 50% clip right now. So we're really drowning in a sea of data. And machine learning and AI is really an attempt to stay ahead of that onslaught of data that's coming at us. It's a way to really make use of the data, and it's a way of making meaning from the data. And that's where these two really, that's where their careers sort of sit. It's the onslaught of data, healthcare data is coming at us, and it's your job to pragmatically put that into practice. So what I'd like to do is just have you introduce yourself, and then we'll just go into some of the questions. So we'll start with you.
Great. My name is Angelique Russell. I'm a data scientist with Precision Health AI. We're a Concerto company, and we are the co-exclusive licensor of ASCO, that's the American Society of Clinical Oncologists database. So I work in the oncology space, and I work with pharmaceutical and payer companies to help leverage real-world data.
Great, and good afternoon, everybody. My name is Darren Dworkin, and I have the pleasure of working at Cedars-Sinai Health System here in Los Angeles. And partly because I have trouble focusing, I have three different roles. I get to be the chief information officer, which means that I get to lead a lot of our operational and production IT, or information technology infrastructure. I'm managing director of a venture fund that we've created so that we can invest in related technologies and bring that innovation back into Cedars-Sinai. And probably the thing I do that is the most fun, although please don't tell the other two, is I get to help lead our accelerator, where about every 10 months or so, we bring in 10 new startups and help try to launch them in the healthcare field.
Awesome. So I'll start with the question, which will set the foundation, which is, where have you seen AI and machine learning be applied in healthcare to date? We'll start with you, then we'll come back over.
You know, it's interesting. I think that the high level answer is everywhere and nowhere. And what I mean by sort of that contradiction is that it is hard these days to talk to any technology company in and around healthcare that doesn't have some AI component. I think that's largely based in the recognition that we as sort of a society, and frankly funded by our government, have spent the last 5 or 8 years or so collecting information. And so the massive investment to deploy electronic medical records all over the United States has been more or less effective. It hasn't sort of reached 100%, but it's certainly passed a tipping point before the ARRA funding of roughly about $30 billion or so sort of occurred. And if you think of the last little while being sort of this massive investment in collecting data, I think people are now just waking up to the idea of, okay, now that you've collected all this information, it might be time to do something with it. So the other half of sort of the contradiction is we're starting to see lots of interest in how to use information, but I think people are also realizing that perhaps their initial thoughts and ambitions might have been a little bit too far forward. And so we're seeing a lot more of information use, frankly, still in terms of reporting and being able to create dashboards and just sort of situational awareness of data, which, you know, it's a little bit of sort of the food and water to maybe what AI is sort of in the future. And so I would say overall, we're just in the very early stages, or if we're allowed to continue the baseball theme, we're still in the very early innings.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that, especially your point about everywhere and nowhere. I think because we're in such a high-tech society, people tend to assume that we're doing a lot more with the data that we collect about our patients than is actually happening in healthcare today. But there's so much opportunity there. Certainly providers are starting to get going with machine learning models that can intervene on a patient who might be developing sepsis. But also in the private sector, pharmaceutical companies are now trying to leverage all of the real world data that's collected on patients so that they can understand things like a rare adverse event, which previously was very difficult to study. But if you're able to aggregate many patients across a population, you can get more information in one data set than we've been able to ever do before.
So, which leads us right into, are there data sets that are more aligned for AI use cases? So if we're looking at it's everywhere and nowhere, but we believe that there is going to be a rapid acceleration, really, of it's just showing up in every product. Almost everybody we talk to says, hey, we can go through all this massive amounts of data. You have claims data, you have electronic medical record data. We're not even starting to take in that data from consumer devices, but there are companies who are saying, hey, we're gonna bring all that in, then we're gonna use ML and AI to really look at that. Are there data sets that are better today than not?
Well, certainly in data science, one thing we think about is how generalizable is the model you're creating. And in order for a model to be generalizable in the population used to train the data set, the data has to look and feel the same as where you're then going to apply that model. When it comes to things like biometrics, you can get fairly consistent, but there's still a great deal of variability about how things are measured.
So biometrics meaning most of the telemetry data we're getting from the bedside and
yeah,
that kind of stuff.
Okay. Yeah, lab values. Outside of things like that, as long as the data set is standardized, very well standardized. So we have a number of vocabularies that we use to standardize healthcare data, like Rx norm to standardize medications, LOINC to standardize labs. That enables us to take data from one provider in California and another provider in New York, and the nature of the data is the same. And then the output can be applied to a provider in Kansas, and everything's fairly similar.
That's great. Anything to add to?
Yeah, it's been interesting for us in terms of looking at sort of the information and sort of what's available to us. I would say that by and large, the types of information that we've been most successful in mining and maybe sort of building some prediction algorithms around has largely been our transactional data. And I think its nature is a little bit easier for us to understand and for us to maybe sort of build parameters around, because we understand it as sort of the daily workflow of what takes place at a large academic medical center. So for example, we spent a lot of time taking a look at our average length of stay and being able to predict what that average length of stay is, with the idea being that if we can understand how long patients will be in the hospital, we can better understand flow and sort of all the different pieces that sort of work around that. And one might think that is a relatively easy thing to do until you go and ask at your health system, hey, what's our average length of stay, only to find out there's probably about 8 different definitions. The finance people have one set, and the clinical people have another, and the clinical people have another, and the clinical people have another. And so, you know, you really have to sort of understand and start to really learn what all that underlying information is. But just generalizing, those things that are taking place every day at Cedars are the easier things for us to begin to get our arms around.
So I'm gonna take this in a direction of really talking about the ethics of AI, and to do that, I'm going to share the story. So Compass is an algorithm widely used in the U.S. to guide sentencing by predicting the likelihood of criminal reoffense. In May of 2016, ProPublica reported that Compass is racially biased. According to the analysis, the system predicts that black defendants pose a higher risk of recidivism than they do, and the reverse for white defendants. The company, of course, denied that that is the case. But the algorithm is proprietary, and it's not open for review of any kind. So it's really hard to determine, you know, which one's really, really accurate. So with that as sort of the background, and we know that AI is going to be coming into healthcare, and especially in the clinical setting where it can potentially do harm or great good. So let's start with transparency. So algorithms really are the secret sauce of these things. However, they're proprietary, and the organizations aren't really forthcoming with, hey, here's what our secret sauce is, we want you to know it. But in order for that to be put into a clinical setting, the physicians want to know it. How is it looking at this data and making these determinations? So, you know, what things are you going to be doing at your, would you recommend that a health system do to really validate the tools before they're put into those cases? We'll start with you.
So our CEO is fond of saying to folks that point out to him that innovation in healthcare is new, that innovation in healthcare turns out isn't that new. Academic medical centers have been around for some time in the US, and people have been coming to get care at them precisely for the innovation that has taken place. What is new is innovation in the delivery of care. Less so around sort of the medical practices themselves. But the reason why I tie those two things together is there's this great ethos and sort of practice in academic medicine around really doing trials around theories that you have and publishing those trials. And the purpose to publish these trials is twofold. One, to share with the world, hey, look what we've discovered. It's really interesting. Do you think it's interesting? Do you have any ideas to build on it? But it's also the world's best peer review, because it really explains in detail, this is how we got there. Or as my grade school math teacher would tell me, you need to show your work before you just sort of give the answer. And so what we've tried to do, in particular with the stuff that we've built within Cedars, is we've tried to tie it together closely with our informaticists, which is a wonderful growing field within sort of healthcare, and really encourage them, and in some cases fund them, to publish what we've been doing. There, of course, is the very simple benefit of the brag factor of, hey, look what we're doing. But through that as well is to actually put into the public domain our formulas and the work that we're doing. And we're hoping that if we can sort of marry up those trends and candidly sort of build on healthcare delivery, the practice of what we've done with medical innovation before that, we can actually set sort of a nice road ahead.
So Angelique, I'd like to talk to you about bias, mm-hmm. right? So the bias in the Compass example may come from the data itself,
yeah.
right? So if there isn't enough data or the type of data, Actually, could you talk a little bit about that? So machine learning and where do the bias sort of comes from limited data sets?
Sure. So especially in the Compass example, the model is just learning what the humans are doing. So you have humans making decisions, and we live in a society where, unfortunately, there's a great deal of systemic racism. It's not surprising that training a model on decisions that humans have been making for decades would then result in racial bias in the model's predictions. Similarly, there are a number of biases that can crop up in when you're working with healthcare data, from payer bias. You know, if you have a patient with certain payers or a high representation of a payer in a certain area, certain tests may not even be available or not be ordered. And your model can pick up signals from that provider not choosing to order the test that don't actually make sense. They're not representative of it. But also just the providers making decisions.
Because machine learning is actually looking for a bias. It's looking for a statistical bias is how it sort of...
It's looking for a signal, right? Like, you know, someone has to make a decision and a signal is happening. I think that there's a great deal to be done around the data that is less biased. And that's what I mentioned earlier about things like biometrics and stuff. Certainly when you're developing a model, you always have to consider how much of it is dependent on things that could be influenced by the providers.
So biometric data, when you hook me up to a heart monitor, there's going to be no bias. You're just going to see my rhythms.
Right? Ideally. Well, whether your Philips monitor is the same as a different brand.
Well, that's true. So are there any methods that we utilize to identify bias in AI models today?
Yeah, so I think that really speaks to the role of more traditional statistics and statistical analysis when we're developing models, which relates to what you're talking about in terms of transparency. But also, you know, when looking for bias and when validating the model, what they do for research and to publish a paper for validation where we look at how well a model is performing retrospectively isn't the whole scope of validation in a clinical setting. There's the ongoing validation when your model is in place, when it's coupled with humans and influencing human decisions, and what are the patient outcomes that result from that, and that really needs to be closely evaluated and studied to understand what your model is doing.
And I think one of the interesting dilemmas that we're going to have to sort of better understand is the data itself. Mm-hmm. And so how many have applied for a job at NASA? All right, so you may remember, or maybe this isn't true, but this was told to me by a couple of folks that are on my team, that there's two, during the interview, there's two stories they tell you. One of them is around the tragic mistake they made between misconverting metric and imperial. As a Canadian, I don't understand why people just can't all move to a metric, but that's a different conversation and talk for a different day. The other is what they describe as the 1% problem. And their 1% problem is that if you start with a mistake really, really early and you don't address it, and you're only 1% off course, you can end up missing the moon, was the analogy that they're sort of famous for talking about, if you don't sort of do your math right, you don't calibrate right. And I sort of say that because I think I tie that back to our data problem, and that is that healthcare has biases in it in terms of who we treat and how medicine is delivered, and there's lots sort of written and lots sort of understood around that. And the reality is that a lot of the data sets that we're working at or working with aren't as broad as one would like to assume they would be. So by way of example, Cedars has done a tremendous amount of work in the cardiology space for women's health. And it probably is not too surprising to learn that a lot of the drug research that's done on heart data and patient data relating to sort of heart illness is focused on white males in their 60s. Because guess what? There was an entire generation that was sort of the totality of sort of the work. And it turns out that women are biologically different in makeup than men, and there's different things that you need to understand. Shocking when you sort of put this sort of back together. But the data sets are much, much smaller. And so I think that one of the things that we're going to have to really start to understand is that if we choose to use technology as this launch or an accelerator in terms of sort of discovering our solution, we're going to have to make sure that we're not 1 or 2 degrees off course at the very, very beginning. Otherwise, we're not going to have the right to be shocked when we sort of miss the mark completely.
So Microsoft's GM of AI design, Tim O'Brien, is encouraging senior leaders to talk about this whole idea of ethics in AI design. Do you foresee a role like that in healthcare, or where do you think that sort of resides? There probably is an ethics role in all healthcare organizations, but are they looking at AI at this point, do you think?
I think there's a definite potential for AI to change access to care in ways that are intended to improve outcomes, outcomes being improved health and reduced cost. When we go to deliver a healthcare, every procedure performed comes with a risk, and if we can reduce the number of people receiving procedures unnecessarily, we can improve outcomes. But anytime you're restricting access to care, having ethicists like ethics at the center of that evaluation and making sure that it's being done ethically and fairly is extremely important.
Yeah. It's interesting. We haven't talked about the promise, and I sort of want to do that. You know, there's this thing, quadruple aim, triple aim, quadruple aim, whatever, you know, if you want to add experience to it. So it's cost, access, quality, and then experience, which is what we're all driving towards or trying to get to in healthcare. And the reality is no physician has enough time in the day to read every journal that's out there and everything that's coming at them. Plus the fact that most of our care is still episodic. So most of the care decisions are being made outside of the hospital itself, right? If somehow we could say to somebody, hey, don't order that Big Mac, because the Big Mac and fries is probably gonna do more harm than, you know, the whatever, 3.5, 4, 5, 10 minutes you're in front of your primary care physician. So the promise of AI and machine learning, I assume, is to start taking that deluge of information and being able to interact with people outside of the care setting. Is that something that health systems are starting to look at, like taking data from that people give permission to from an iPhone or from, we used to say Fitbit, I guess not anymore, it's Apple Watch. I mean, Apple's just gonna take over the whole setting. But it's but those kinds of devices to try to deliver a better care. We heard about population health, going from episodic care to population care. Is that where machine learning is really going to play a role, or are we just going to hire 10,000 more people at Cedars to care for these people?
Well, listen, I love the idea of hiring 10,000 more, and if you can just write a letter of approval to my CEO and CFO, that would be wonderful. But I think what we're starting to see is there's lots of different sort of uses for AI generally. I want to make sure I sort of leave some optimism and sort of positive examples in terms of some of the work that we're doing, in particular in the field of clinical decision support. So this is the idea of how can we look back at some information and give ourselves a little gentle tap on the shoulder. It's probably getting harder and harder for us to imagine driving anywhere without a GPS or Waze or Google Maps or whatever, you know, we sort of choose to use. Medicine is quickly becoming the same thing for precisely what you pointed out, in that there's more written around healthcare discovery almost every day than, you know, somebody can possibly sort of consume in their field. But even more than that, I think that there's this wonderful potential equalizer. I think that many of us probably in this room are fortunate in that we can get our care from physicians, but a lot of folks can't get their care from a physician. They might get their care from a physician extender, and one of the ways in which they can get some of the same knowledge that's within sort of larger sort of training programs is through clinical decision support, through some pathways and algorithms and sort of things like that. So we're seeing some great sort of movement there. We're also seeing some great uses of AI as it relates to imaging, in terms of focusing what we know are challenges in terms of radiologists and others looking at images and how your eyes get tired and you may not pick things up, and some really interesting science in terms of where you focus and where you don't focus, and saying, hey, you may want to look at this area or double check sort of on that area. And so I think there's a lot of things that can get used. I think the danger in my mind is, I think, a little bit of this sort of Silicon Valley idea that we're going to disrupt our way through the solution. I still have trouble sort of getting my arms completely around, because on the one hand, there's no question that big academic medical center healthcare has to figure out how to move just a wee bit faster. But on the other, we don't want to move so fast that we're sort of rushing through validation and testing and some of the important sort of protocols that sort of need to be put in place to make sure that if we're going to rely on technology, it's really doing the right thing.
Yeah, I totally agree. And to your point about physician extenders, we do have a shortage of doctors already, and globally it's going to get worse in the coming years. And I really see a role for AI in dictating how much information needs to be gathered before there is even a person-to-person interaction. So instead of going to your doctor and then going to get a number of labs and then coming back to your doctor for resolution, we can algorithmically determine based on your symptoms and your present health what information you should be bringing into a clinical setting to add efficiency to the system.
Fantastic. Well, I was going to open it up. Is there time? So we'll open up to you guys for questions.
Megan, I just wanted to point out on the COMPASS, which was it's a recidivism assessment algorithm that actually went to court, and the issue of transparency came up, and the court sided on with the company that's now called Equivant, and said that, you know, it's a proprietary issue, and so no, we're not going to go in there and take a look at the inside the black box. But another recent case called KW within the healthcare setting, the court actually said no, we need to make the algorithm transparent to the patients. It had to do with patients that were developmentally incapacitated, and so with their services, with regard to their benefits, that they would have a right so to access the inner workings of the algorithm. So we're seeing a little bit of a change there. So that's kind of interesting to look at the contrasts as well. And then there's a new law in New York City with regard to transparency that they implemented a task force. So we're seeing a move ahead in that area.
Yeah, our company, Concerto, we're assuming that transparency is going to be regulated and required. I think it's a safe assumption to make today, especially with the FDA's oversight and their increasing opinion that algorithms are a type of medical device.
And I went to the 40 as well.
And you know, what I point out to some folks is that, especially when they're sort of early stage founders at sort of startups, there's sort of this idea that they really have to hold on to their secret sauce and sort of their IP in terms of what they have. And you know, the not so little secret in healthcare delivery in hospitals is that it's not so much about the IP, it's really about the methodology you put around it. We don't suffer from knowing what we need to do, we suffer from being able to figure out how to roll out what we need to do. And so I think it's very much around sort of the methodology and the workflow. And so I'm rather optimistic that I think some of these algorithms are going to start to become a little bit more public. And frankly, would even give kudos to our friends at Apple, who, in my own view, up until now, have developed a watch that was basically based on wellness for really fit people to figure out how to become even more fit. The latest that they've worked on in terms of their heart monitor, for the first time, you know, they are doing some open studies around that, and they're going to take them through peer review, and they're going to publish them, which is, I think, what we're going to start to see more and more of.
I have a question about access. One of the things we think about in education is the digital divide and this notion of getting the tools in the hands of everybody. So I love the example of the smartwatch and the harvesting of data, but it occurs to me that the data set would be pulled from people that can afford a smartwatch, and that's a very segmented part of the population. So I'm wondering what role in how does healthcare fit into this to help equalize and get, if it's going to be AI that's providing medical information to you, if everybody doesn't have an app or doesn't have access to an Amazon device to go through that exercise, how do we kind of equalize access? Is that the role of healthcare, or do you see that more being the marketplace or insurance?
Boy, that's a complicated question. You know, I think that there's a lot of dimensions to that. Maybe I'll just sort of offer a clarification, and I'll answer one part of the question. The clarification is that, you know, while it's sexy to sort of talk about Fitbits and Apple Watches and sort of gathering sort of patient sort of information, It's not a tremendously big piece of what we're doing, and in many cases, it's pretty tangential to most of the work that we're doing. I think the larger point that I'll make is that the digital divide is interesting. Certainly, there's a healthcare divide. I don't know that many would sort of argue against that. What we are finding, though, is that we're trying to move as quickly as we can to get as many of our tools to be mobile first, largely because we're able to get them to a larger and more diverse population who are using mobile technologies, whether it's Android or iOS, more so than what otherwise was available through even web or even home phone numbers. And so I think that for some very, very simple things like patient reminders to come back for your visit, turns out, not surprisingly, it's easier to reach people across a larger array through a text message than it is to call them at home for some of the very obvious reasons, socioeconomic, that underline underneath that. So I actually think that, at least in my view, there's some optimism there in that perhaps sort of mobile technology will act to sort of be of a level setter.
Have either of you come across any situations where artificial intelligence led to unintended negative consequences? And how did you deal with those situations?
I haven't seen that happen yet. I think the potential is huge. So I've definitely stayed up at night thinking about how algorithms I'm developing could be misused once they come out in the world. And I think the need to have ethical oversight over the implementation of your algorithms is really important. But an example I could give is when I was at City of Hope, we developed an algorithm to identify patients for whom we wanted end-of-life planning. So these are patients who are cancer patients, they're arriving at their end of life. We have a very benign goal. We want them to get an advance directive so that we can make sure we're exercising upon their wishes. But that algorithm itself, now we're able to predict mortality. You take that algorithm and you give it to a different stakeholder, like a payer who doesn't want to pay for expensive hospital visits at end of life and who would rather have their patient in hospice care. And now you have a whole different scenario where you could potentially have a patient being put down a path by what their payer wants and not necessarily their own wishes because of the algorithm.
There's somebody that I work with that is fond of saying when they're asked, how are things working at the hospital, or how is everything going, and they'll quickly answer, everything I know about is working great. And so maybe to sort of leverage on that, everything we know about seems to be okay, but I think that's largely because we should be thankful around the role that the FDA is playing in this.
Yeah.
And that is that much of what is taking place today is considered secondary alerting or secondary review. And is not yet sort of the primary function. Today, most of the primary function that we would think through in the various examples is relying on clinical experts, which, by the way, is kind of what we want. That's why you go see these clinical experts. I think the real ethical dilemma is going to happen is when we're making that shift, what risk tolerance are we really willing to have? And so, it's one of these things where when human lives are sort of in the balance, is 99.59's okay? Maybe at a macro level, if you're sort of talking about it in a classroom, but if it's your mom in the hospital, probably not. And so it becomes a really difficult dilemma for us to sort of get through. And it will be interesting in the years ahead where the FDA actually chooses to make that decision.
Hi. I wonder, as you talk about using machine learning algorithms here, and I wonder if how you're thinking about the problems with the black box nature of those algorithms. So they provide an answer, but they don't necessarily allow you to understand how the answer was come to. And that's part of the issue with understanding when there's bias. If you could see the explanation behind the answer, you might be able to tell if there's been missing information or the things coming up with a dumb answer for that reason. On the other hand, if not having an explanation might sometimes be a hindrance to deploying an algorithm that you know should be used, and so there are ethical issues on both sides. So I wonder about how you think about that kind of problem.
Yeah, I mean, that's such an interesting question. I think we try to avoid black box algorithms whenever possible. So if you can use a more interpretable model so that you can convey information about how your model is working, that's worth doing. Another thing you can do, to his point about the clinicians are still in charge in these workflows, is you can present the information going into the model in a like a tailored sort of way in a dashboard that enables the clinician to arrive at the same decision that the model is predicting. So in my example of a mortality predictor for end-of-life planning, the reason we have that tool is because published literature shows that oncologists over-prognosticate. They overestimate their patient's remaining time, and we're trying to correct that with data. But they're still the ones in charge of their patient care. So what we're trying to do is change the physician's mind about the approaching end of life. And we're giving them information, not just a prediction, but your patient has lost greater than 10% of their body weight in the last 90 days. These are their recent admissions. This is what they've been dealing with as side effects. We think the patient has 50 days left. And in the context of that clinical data, what we really want is for the clinician to agree with the algorithm. And they don't actually need to know which of those variables informed the prediction and which way and what the coefficients are.
I think there's a great example that is actually quite tragic and unfortunate that we can all learn from. It's the story of Theranos. For those of you that like to read, there's a book, I believe it's called Bad Blood, and I think it's even going to be made into a Hollywood movie around the story. But I think it's truly the dangers of what happens when you sort of need to rely on sort of this black box and really what can sort of take place.
Yeah.
Thank you so very much to Bill and Angelique and to Darren. Thank you so much. I'm just going to transition to the next step, and if you'd like to, I'm sorry about those uncomfortable chairs. Thank you.